you will be able to see me. So
Yes.
whatever we talk will be heard. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just be aware of it. Yeah. Okay, fine.
Sure.
Now we can you can unmute and then ask me questions whenever you wish to.
Sure, sir. Until then, I'll stay on mute.
Yes.
நேத்து எவ்வளோ வாங்கினீங்க காசு?
நேற்று 50 சார். காலையில் இட்லி மீன் கிட்டுக்கேன் பில்லோட.
எவ்வளோ காலையில்
Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to day two of our webinar on soft skills training. We are doing it live through the YouTube channel, and we are telecasting live on Learning Circle Academy channel. Thank you very much for your participation and your inputs and your questions yesterday. So today we will be covering the session on communication and motivation. So today we will be looking at communication and motivation. So before we start the session, certain information in terms of how the session will progress. We will be looking at presentation in two parts, one on communication and one on motivation. My suggestion would be to take the questions at the end. So please request you to write down your questions at the later part of it. When I ask you to write your questions, I have your student coordinator, classmate Vedika Jain, who will read me out the questions. Yesterday, we had some feedback saying that there is a time lag between you asking the question and me responding. So to ensure that we minimize that and we are able to speed up and do it faster. So she will read out the questions at the end of it when you start writing down the questions. The questions, you will put it in the comment section. So, and at end of it, after the questions have been answered, we will put in the feedback form for the day two of the program, wherein you can type out, you can click on that Google form and give you a feedback, which will be relayed back to your college directly. Please keep a notebook with you to write down your thoughts, your questions that may come about it. Now, in terms of the webinar today, in terms of communication and motivation, one of the questions as students or as individuals, all of us have to ask is whether we are attending a webinar, whether we are attending a class, whether we are participating in a discussion. The question that have to be asked is, why am I doing this? What am I doing this? How does this help or how does this process work? What are the steps involved in that? It's extremely important because this webinar, although we are only doing it for 2 hours, my endeavor would be to ensure that you as participants here listening to this through the YouTube channel of Learning Circle Academy, that you use it extremely well when you go back into your personal lives, in your college life, in your family life, and in future in your professional lives. See, the endeavor of this program or the webinar is it should be utilitarian, which means that I must be able to use it when I go back. I must be able to learn it and share it to people if required and use it effectively. As I said, in various fora that I'm going to be involved in or you're going to be involved in. It must also be exciting. It must also be interesting. It must also be pragmatic, otherwise known as practical. Although we have a short duration, I have ensured that various topics are covered, various inputs are provided. My endeavor that would be you go further and read these topics further in books that you have or books that you want to acquire, or you can use the Google search to find out. This video that you are viewing will be available on our channel. It will not be removed definitely for now. It will be there. You can use it. You can come and visit. You can look at the video again to understand certain concepts again. However, my request would be that you write it down so that these questions that are there with you will stay with you. You don't have to come again and do it. Although you're most welcome to do that, the quick reference helps to write it down. Now, the questions that would be asked from a communication standpoint for the next about 45 minutes, an hour, is that, does it matter how I speak or write? Does it matter? I know how to do that. I know how to communicate. I know how to write. I know how to interact with people. So do I have to learn anything more? Is there a difference between verbal communication, written communication? The common aspects of communication are verbal and written. Now, whether it's a social media that you are writing, or it's an email that you're writing, or a letter that you're writing, all comes under the written communication. Now, when you speak to somebody over the phone or face-to-face, or through in terms of using visual communication or video conferencing, all comes under verbal communication. The most important question is, both in terms of as a receiver and as a sender, how do I make my communication effective? Because communication is the foundation for every other aspect of our work life, whether we are talking about problem solving, or whether we are talking about even motivation, or whether we are looking at negotiation, any interviewing, attending interviewing, debating, or whether it's group discussions, every aspect of it in our lives, communications becomes the foundation of it. So view it from various perspectives and keep those questions lingering in. My endeavor would be that how much ever questions it's possible, we will make an attempt to respond to it at the later part of it. But please also keep in mind, there's a 2-hour webinar. So I'm looking at stopping it about, completing it by at about 3:30, so that you have enough time to ask questions and respond. And also you have time to fill in the feedback form afterwards. Now, communication process. Now, this is something maybe some of you are aware of it. If you're aware of it, it is just a reiteration of it. If you're not aware of it, you can look at it with a fresh eyes perspective, because you would be looking at it for the first time. In terms of who are the people involved, what are the aspects involved in communication process? There is a sender and receiver. It can be many people sitting there, yet there is one sender, many receivers, but from our description perspective, using it as a receiver. Now, there is a sender, there is a receiver. There is a message that needs to be communicated to that particular person, or I'm receiving that if I'm the receiver. There is a medium that we talked about, several media we talked about it, whether it could be social medium, or in terms of a telephone, or whether it's a webinar sort of telecommunication channel we are using, or whether it's an email, whether it's a letter, whether it's a Facebook that we're typing it out. So what medium am I using it? And what's the context? Very important is what's the context? What's the situation? With what perspective am I communicator? Am I receiving this communication? So these are the factors involved in it. So you will find that there is a sender here. He or she develops an idea. Encoding here. Encoding, we are not using from a IT perspective. Encoding is that I am using my mechanisms, my approaches. To, like, for example, now I am talking to you. I am the center and you are the receiver. Now, if you look at it, I want to communicate about communication process. So I am verbalizing it. I am using this presentation to talk to you. So I'm encoding it, I'm structuring it, and I am transmitting it to you. Now you're receiving it. It could be on your mobile phone, or it could be on your laptop or a desktop. So you are receiving it now. When you receive it, you are decoding it. You are decoding with your perspectives. The words I used, you will interpret it, you will infer it, you will intake it in your own way. Now, and then you accept it. Maybe you may not accept it also. You may accept it. And then you will use it. So this is the communication process. So sender looks at it. I have an idea. I have a point. I have an input to share. I structure it. I encode it. I transfer it or transmit it. There is a receiver. You receive it. You will decode it, or you use it your own structural way. You accept it, and then you apply it in your environment, in your life, in your situation. Now, there are two types of communication. There is a one-way communication. There is a two-way communication. Now, if the Prime Minister is talking to us, it's a one-way communication. Now, if the Prime Minister is talking to us on Mann Ki Baat, it's a one-way communication. He's addressing to us for a particular issue. Yes, it is a one-way communication. Now, the same Prime Minister writes a message on Twitter. Now, is that a one-way communication? It will immediately become a two-way communication because there is a provision for me to respond, for me to write, for me to react, for me to express my own thought. So let's look at terms of one-way, two-way. What are the differences which are there in it? One-way communication is fast. Now, at this point of time, it may look like that my presentation is one-way and I may tend to agree that, but yet you have a provision to type out your thoughts, your observations, your feelings, your questions. So even though it's one way, we are making a strong attempt to make it a two way. Now, communication in terms of one way, it's very fast. I just have to tell you, it is very effective, appears very effective, but sometimes it may be the why they use the word is inaccurate is that the way one person says. Now, there is a same prime minister or a chief minister or a leader is addressing over television, is talking. Now, it's effective. It appears very effective, very impressive. But it may not reach out totally. I cannot check. I cannot ask. I cannot clarify. So, lacks opportunity for feedback, which is what we mentioned about it. So, to make it effective, to make it accurate, there is a lot of planning required by the sender, whoever is the sender. So extreme planning is required. So after the person who is speaking has to think through, okay, now how will this word be interpreted? Who is the type of audience coming there and sitting there? What background are they coming from? How will they interpret this metaphor? How will they interpret this analogy? How will they interpret this example? How will they interpret this anecdote? How will they interpret from their cultural perspective? Especially when you are addressing multicultural people or multilinguistic people. So there is a lot of planning required by the sender so that you have to be careful with the words that is used. Now, even here, if I'm addressing students here in Chennai, some of you are familiar with Hindi. So sometimes I can take the liberty to use some words in Hindi, but otherwise I may not be able to use it because it may not be understood. For example, when we go to North, there is a communication happening in Tamil. How many people will be able to relate with that? I mean, so I have to be sensitive. Even if you look at when Prime Minister addressed when he spoke to the soldiers, he made a reference to Thiruvalluvar court. So what did he do? He made a reference to the Thiruvalluvar court, which is in Tamil. He made a lot of effort to speak that. However, he also knows that people sitting there, many of them may not understand the Tamil. So what did he do? He did a translation of it. So that's a planning that goes into it, saying that, okay, I may make a reference, but let me explain in depth as to what is the perspective I'm bringing this particular example, or why am I making a reference here, or what is the description of it? Yes, one-way communication is less threatening. So I have to stand there and speak. So I don't have to be worried about, will I be countered? Will I be questions? I just have to speak. So typically television, when the news readers, when they speak, when they read out the news, it's not threatening for them. They just take out, read the news, go. It can make the receiver frustrated. Sometimes you wonder, when will they cover this particular point? When will they talk about this issue? Why are they coming to this particular aspect of it, which I'm looking at? Why are they not talking about this news which happened in Albania? Why are they not talking about this news that happened in Assam? Why are they not talking about this news that happened in Chennai? So it can make people frustrated. Now, let's take a two-way communication. It's definitely so because there is a possibility to interact. So it will be slow. However, it is very accurate. So people can ask, people can clarify, people can check, people can confirm their understanding. So that's what it makes it availability of a feedback loop. And that makes planning less essential. I don't have to think too much about it in terms of, okay, so if somebody stopped me and say, no, I don't agree with you on that. So I can say, okay, so why you don't agree? Oh, acha, okay, so this is an issue here. So I can rephrase and restructure. So that's a possibility in a two-way communication. However, the sender is vulnerable. There is an element of risk involved. That's where yesterday, if you realize that some of you had asked about stage fear. Now, although we will not be able to address in this session, but stage fear comes about it because there is a vulnerability. There is an element of risk to stand there. Oh, what will they tell me? Will they question me? And would I not be able to answer that particular question? Or will they ask something which is out of syllabus? Or will they ask something for which I may not have an answer? So there is an element of vulnerability. However, the receiver is more confident. The receiver is able to look at it in terms of its strength because he or she can respond, can react, can ask. So this in terms of one-way and two-way communication. One-way and two-way is also in a way called as a passive communication and active communication. Passive is just communicating. Active, there is a conversation, there is an interaction, there is a discussion. That's one part of it. So we looked at communication process and also we looked at what is one-way and two-way communication? So we have looked at two aspects of it. Now let's look at five C's of communication. Now when we're looking at five C's of communication, this is keeping in mind both the verbal aspect of communication and also the written aspect of communication. Now, I'm just not taking it only the verbal aspect or written only. It is both. So it's extremely important that you also view it from that particular perspective when we discuss this. So when we talk about clarity or completeness or conciseness or correctness or being courteous, now please look at it from both verbal and written perspective. Now, what is clarity? What is clarity of communication? One thing that you'll have to keep in mind in clarity of the communication is that, am I clear in what I want to communicate in my mind? Now the clarity has to be here. Only when the clarity is there in my mind would I be able to ensure that I'm able to transfer that clarity to the other person who is listening to me. What's the objective of communication? What is the purpose of this communication? Sometimes I have to ponder over, has this issue been discussed prior? If the issue has been discussed prior, so like for example, communication program itself that we are talking about it, some of you may have gone through this session, you may have read about it somewhere. So that's the reason why I say that, okay, view it with a fresh eyes perspective if you've already gone through that. Now look at it in terms of what is the purpose of this communication, and also look at in terms of make it easier for the receiver to be able to understand from where I am coming from. So it's only not only in terms of purpose of this communication, and also has this topic been addressed before, and also I have to make it easier in terms of receiving this information. So clarity has to be looked at in terms of that also. People shouldn't be reading between the lines. Sometimes people quote pun. Yes, sometimes it is good to quote pun. It is good to make some analogical references or use some metaphors. Yes, it is useful to do that. But sometimes you also have to look at it. I'm not assuming that they will read between the lines or read those inferences which I'm wanting to make. So then I am not clear in my communication aspect of it. So how do I make it clear? So one is in terms of phrase simple sentences so that they are effective. So use exact, simple, appropriate, relevant words and also ensure that few aspects of it are talked about it in a line, in a sentence, rather than too many points being talked about it in the same sentence or a line. So that's in terms of clarity. Now, can I be complete in my communication? Yes, clarity is there. Can I be complete in my communication? Completeness is also looked at in terms of my message is complete when it contains all the facts that the receiver needs for the reaction that you may want to go about it and do it. When we take a particular topic, like I'm saying here, in the communication program that we're discussing now, I am going to give you a brief about various aspects of it. It would be my endeavor to request you to go back and read more about it. So my endeavor is to cover as much as possible about communication skills. Yet, I mean, although I may not be able to go deeper, can I envelop as much as possible my communication inputs to you? So people may come with different filters in terms of different backgrounds. So we have to keep that perspective in mind. So how do I do it in my incompleteness? Can I respond to as many questions as possible? Can I provide all the information that is possible? Also look at it in terms of what am I communicating? How am I communicating? Why am I communicating? Where am I communicating? When am I communicating? So look at it from various the W's and the H. So look at it in terms of various aspects of it so that it becomes comprehensive, it becomes complete, it becomes a holistic communication. Sometimes it's also good to look at call to action so that sometimes the receiver, what should I do with this information? Okay, you've told me about it. If it's a television news, I'm watching it. Fine, there's nothing to be done about it. For example, now we are in the pandemic times. So sometimes when they say that, okay, now this is the problem, so many lives are being affected. Okay, you have to wear a mask, you have to do that. So they go about explaining wear this type of mask. This is how you should wear a mask. When you go out, you must wear a mask. You must maintain social distancing. This is the distancing you must maintain. All these are call to action that is being done. So we looked at clarity. We looked at completeness. Now let's look at conciseness. Although I must be comprehensive, I must be complete, I must also ensure that I just stick to the rule of just give as much information as it is necessary. Too much information being given does not make it complete or comprehensive. It becomes overloading of information. When there is too much of information, people wonder which one to take. Is it important? What is important among the so much of messages that are being given? So we must ensure that preciseness, conciseness. Now let's take the same webinar. Now instead of a 2-hour webinar, now you have to listen to a 4-hour webinar. Just visualize 2 to 6. You have to sit there and listen. You'll wonder, can I take a break? Can I come back? Can you make it 2 sessions? So that's where the conciseness is in terms of just right enough time. That's where this 2 hours has been brought. Just enough time to be able to sit and take in the inputs possible. Now, how would I be concise in my communication? Too much of wordy, too much of repetition. Ensure that minimum words are used, yet keeping in mind the other C's of it. So we have to ensure the other C's are kept. Sometimes it's also good to minimize or eliminate, for instance, you know, definitely, kind of. So sometimes when people use that, they are called the filler words. So sometimes when I'm speaking, I don't know what to speak. So when I don't know what to speak, I say, see, you know, like that, kind of, actually, I don't know, what are you trying to tell me? So it will help to practice. Like yesterday, people asked about stage fear. One input I can tell you that is, how do I bring about conciseness in stage fear? When I have stage fear, when I have to address. The risk of the stage fear is that when you go on stage, either you keep talking a lot or you actually talk very little. So when you're talking very little, so the tension has taken on to you. When you're talking a lot, you've got comfortable standing there and you're enjoying it and you're forgetting the whole purpose why we came there. So there is a risk of either side of it. So how do I bring in conciseness in my public speech or when I'm addressing a group of people is to learn to practice in front of the mirror. This is one of the oldest tricks of public speaking. Stand in front of the mirror. Literally, don't sit and talk in front of the mirror. Stand and speak in front of the mirror. When you stand in front of the mirror, one, you are seeing yourself. Two, you are hearing yourself more effectively. And then you know this word is not good, that word is not good. I have to reduce this. I have to expand it. So a lot of learning will come about it when you practice in front of the mirror. And also brings in conciseness. So when you write down the points, like for example, I write down my presentations. I write down like what are the slides here I have with me in the sheet of paper. That's concise. So I know that if I'm looking at now, this is the 11th slide. So I want to know what is the 12th slide somewhere if I have forgotten about it. I just have to look at it. 12th slide is talking about correctness. So I know that. So practice will help in terms of keeping and making it concise, precise, focused. Now let's look at the fourth C aspect of it, correctness. We looked at clarity, we looked at completeness, we looked at conciseness, and we're looking at correctness. It is not that social media has killed grammar. Grammar is very challenging, whichever language that we take, whether it is Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, or English. Grammar is something which we take it for granted. We don't make an attempt. And considering that at this point of time, business language is English, business communication is English, the Facebook communication is English, LinkedIn communication is English, Twitter communication is English. So since bulk of the communications by and large happens in English, it helps to pick up the correctness of grammar of that particular language in terms of punctuations, in terms of spelling, in terms of what is the meaning of those words that are being used. And also, is it appropriate? Is it accurate? Is it the right word that I'm using for this communication? Extremely important that we choose the right words. In terms of if you want to look at how to pick the right word, sometimes I'm lost. I don't know what words to use. What is a similar word? You can always Google when you're lost about it and look for a word and type out a synonym for it. So all the synonyms would be mentioned there. So you can pick the appropriate. See, please understand each word as appropriateness to the situation. You remember we talked about context when it came to communication process in the first slide, we talked about it. Now, each word is relevant to the context that is being used. Now, if the context is a problem, now you may want to use one particular word. If the context is crisis, you may want to use another word. If the context is enjoyment or fun, you may want to use another particular word. So the same word, the same purpose of same meaning that you want to communicate may get transferred differently in different contexts. So just be aware of that. Use the right level of language. Spell all names and titles correctly. Extremely important to use the Mr. or Ms. When you don't know, for women, Ms. is the safest one to use. There are doctorates in your college, professors. Please address them as Dr. Dot. It's extremely important. It is not that they are asking for it. It is important that we give the salutations or the titles appropriately. In terms of designations, we have to give it correctly. If somebody is an associate professor, please make sure you write it as associate professor and not as assistant professor. It will not be taken very well, which means that I have not made an attempt to understand that person's title before I wrote a message to that particular message. It is also important to proofread. Some of the tendencies, thanks to the computer revolution, the tendency of today is to let the Microsoft Word do the proofread, whilst yes, it will give you a indication in terms of there is a spelling error or there is a grammatical error. There are a lot of sort of apps that have come to check the grammar, but it will be very useful and helpful that you do the correction first. While you may take the advice of MS Office technology to be able to proofread, it would always be good. The reason is very simple. You will learn spelling whilst you're doing that. So when you're typing out, sometimes spellings get missed out. So when you correct it, the correct spelling will remain with you so that in future, you don't have to make a mistake. Courteous. Whilst clarity, completeness, conciseness, and correctness is important, courtesy is extremely important. There must be sincerity, there must be thought, it must not irritate people, it must not be negative, it must be pleasant. Please use pleases and thank yous when you do that, kindly, for your kind information. May I request you to do that? Thank you very much for having read through my profile. Thank you very much. Especially many of you must be applying for jobs or must be connecting with people. It is good to use please and thank you. And please mean it when you do that, because it will get communicated through words. We will look at it in a brief while how it would happen. So it's extremely important to be polite and courteous to people. Okay, sometimes when you're angry, when you're writing a message, my humble request would be that don't write the message then. it is better to not write a message when you are angry and be discourteous. It's better to wait for a while, and then when you are calmed down and when things have settled down in your frame, so that, okay, now let me write it down. So positive words will come. When you are angry, when you are irritated, when you are frustrated, either with the sender or with somebody else, it will reflect in the communication. That person will wonder, what has happened to this person? This is not the way he or she responds. Is she or he angry with me? Is she or he upset with me? So feelings do get communicated, so that please be careful in terms of being courteous in the communication. So we looked at clarity, completeness, conciseness, correctness, and courtesy. Clarity in terms of, am I clear? Am I focused? Completeness, am I comprehensive? Am I precise in my communication? Am I using the correct words, correct titles, correct anecdotes? Am I courteous in my communication? Okay, now one of the aspects of it which we talked about it is people get to read my feelings. Now, there was a study done almost 70 years back, still very relevant today, that especially let's take with a face-to-face communication to begin with. Now, when there is a face-to-face communication, there is a possibility that the receiver who's standing there in front of me, now he or she is able to look at me from head to toe and form an opinion about what am I saying, what is my body saying, what is my tone saying, what are my feelings with which am I coming with. All of these are visible for the person who is listening to me face to face. Now, even here when I'm addressing you, in terms of when we say voice inflection or body language. So you see me that sometimes I move forward, I go back, sometimes I'm like this. So all these are body languages. Say I'm using my hand. So all these are body language movements that are there. Now that's the 55% of it that people pick up in a communication. Out of 100% of communication that is transferred from me to you, 55% of it, you pick it up from the body language, whether it's out of highlighting a particular subject, or whether it's emphasizing a particular subject, or whether it's a utility part of it, the body language communicates to it to you in terms of 55%. 38% is the tonality, the inflection, the way with which I speak, the emphasis that I make. Now, when I'm talking about Albert Mehrabian's study, so I can say the same thing differently. Albert Mehrabian's study. So I can say it, so many aspects of it in terms of where the emphasis needs to be. So all this is viewed from an inflection perspective or a tonality perspective. Now, the question that is being asked is that in this pandemic situation, or even otherwise, when we use WhatsApp to speak, WhatsApp video to talk to people, listen to people. No, you only get to see half of it. You don't get to see the full part of it. You don't get to see below the waist. At best, it's little above the waist is what you see. Now, how do we form the opinion of the person without not being able to see the whole body? The answer is two-way. Still, the 100% communication is picked up. So, which means that 55% is formed based on what is visible from here. Now, what I do with my legs, you don't get to see, but you form an opinion based on how I use my palms, how I use my face, how I use my shoulders. Am I shrugging? Am I erect? You pick up. So, this also brings about a concept called congruency of communication. Now, congruency means that there is a word being said, but the body is not accepting that. So typically, a simple example, if somebody is asking about, did you eat food today morning? Now, somebody may turn around and say, yeah, I ate food today morning. Now, you see that when I said I ate food today morning, I put my palm close to my mouth. Now, what does it indicate? So there is a message being communicated. The same question is asked, and did you have a breakfast in the morning? Yes, yes, of course I had breakfast in the morning. Look at that. And another perspective, yeah, of course I had breakfast in the morning. So isn't there a difference? So you pick it up. So let's say I'm not even keeping my arms forward. I'm not using my arms at all to cover up or to use my palms to cover up. So you're asking me, have you had your breakfast today? Yeah, I had breakfast today. So there is a change. So you pick up, so you make your inferences from there. And let me tell you that there are a lot of books on body language written where they talk about it in terms of emphasis of what Albert Mehrabian's study said. People pick up the body language first, even before they pick up the word. Now, when I'm telling you that something, I've had my breakfast today, I've had my breakfast, then my hand goes up, you have picked my signal first there. Or I may say that you're asking me, have you had your breakfast today morning? So look at there and say, yeah, I've had my breakfast today morning. Now, immediately when I turn around that, let's say that, no, is he telling the truth? Why is he looking there? Why is he covering his mouth? Is he telling the truth? So that's where the congruency of the words come about it. So the congruency is in terms of the words I speak, the tonality in terms of tone that I speak, and also in terms of the body language that I display. Now, people communicate anger through their body language. People communicate their frustration through body language. People communicate their irritation through body. Everything is communicated. Now, there are another question comes about it. Now, when all these can be communicated through body language, face-to-face, or through this webinar, now, how would a communication be made through email communication? Now, there is no body language to be seen. Now, yes, body language is not to be seen, but let me tell you that the person who's receiving the communication is somewhere unknowingly visualizing the communication as if this person is reading to that person, or from the words that is written there, inferences are being made about the implications of the message. The words say something. The implications would say something else. So the words are not viewed with total trust. The implications are viewed and say, no, the person is saying something else rather than what the person has written. Because the structuring of the words will communicate in terms of, you can ask, you can look at it. I'm sure when you read WhatsApp messages and Facebook messages, and if you're on LinkedIn messages, you will find that this does not seem to be genuine. This seems to be something missing here. So you will pick the incongruency there, although you are not, the person is not visible there. Okay, so we looked at communication process, communication model. We looked at one-way, two-way communication. We looked at the 5 C's of communication. We looked at Albert Mehrabian's study about body language, 55%, tonality, 38%, and the words only constitute 7%. So let's look at some other concepts of communication. There is a questioning skill. There is a listening skill. So questioning skill, I'll just take you through. This is just to make you aware of it so that you can go back and read more about it. There are two types of questions. There are several types of sub-classifications of these question types, but I'm just picking up the broad motherhood types of questions, which is open-ended and closed-ended. Open-ended are what, when, where, how, when. Sorry, there's a mistake here. What, when, where, how, who. It's a typographical error. My apologies on that. In terms of closed, is, are, may. So also you see in the open, I've put a cross on the why. Minimize asking the why question. Why sounds little interrogative. Why didn't you come yesterday? Why didn't you come to our function day before yesterday? Why didn't you pick up my call? It's a little interrogative. Rephrase it. What made you to not pick up my call? Were you tied up when I picked up the call, or something like that, rather than why didn't you pick up the call? I understand maybe you're tied up. So what were the reasons that you did not pick up my call? So just phrase it a little more softly. Close questions. Is this being done? Are they coming in? May I come in? So open-ended question leads to a little more wider answers. Although when is about time, where is about location, and who is about a person. Yet there is openness in terms of I don't know what time it would be or location where. So there is a little more openness on that. Whereas closed is predominant of the questions in close would be a yes or no question. Is it right for me to ask? Is this the right dress or is this okay to do? Are they coming for the meeting? May I come in? May I go out? May I take a leave? May I come in tomorrow morning and meet up with you? So these are common ones. Some of them still use can, will, and should. But be careful about it. Can is predominantly a capability question. So can should be replaced with a may because may is seeking permission. Will I be able to do that is something you have to ask him. Asking the other person may not help. Should I do this? Yes, you can do. You can ask this question. But just be aware that I don't make it sound a little arrogant on that. Should you be doing this? Should, when I start using for myself, I may start using for others also. Should you be doing this right now? It sounds a little interrogative. Will you be able to come tomorrow morning? So replace it saying, how are you placed tomorrow morning to come over for us to meet up? So make it a little more open-ended. So these are questions in terms of open-ended and closed-ended. Now let's look at some of the barriers to listening. Just a moment. These are some of the common barriers to listening. So when, let's say you are talking to me and there is a background noise that is going on, or there is a phone ringing for me, or somebody is knocking at the door. So these are distractions. Detour, I'm talking to you about barriers to listening. Let's say a distraction. I talked about somebody knocking at the door. So maybe you are thinking about somebody knocking at the door in your house and how you went and opened the door and what you did about it. And you've detoured there and you missed the point here. So that's a detour. You pick a word from what is being said and you hijack yourself to another world. You detour. You detour means that you take a tour outside of, you go outside of where you are part of it. So you take a detour to it. So once you go there, sometimes I'm not even aware. So I'm wandering around. I'm thinking about it, of some words that have been talked about it. Let's say I'm talking about holiday in Mauritius. So immediately somebody's thinking about Mauritius, holiday, traveling there, spending time there with the family. So that's a detour. So distraction, detour, debating. Debating can be two ways. One, I may debate in my own mind. Is this correct? What is he saying? What is he talking about this? Yesterday, it did not happen there. I may do a debate in my own mind, or I may debate with a person, which is even worse. So when I debate with that, I stop listening. So he wanted to say a particular point. He or she is wanting to say something, but I'm debating with that particular person rather than waiting for the person to complete it. So there's distraction, there is detour, there is debating, there is daydreaming. Typically, I remember my college professor used to tell us, I'm sure that it must be happening with you in the college also. Daydreaming is that the professors or faculty members say that you're physically present, you're mentally absent. So that's a daydreaming. So I am wandering around, I am dreaming about something else, no connection to the topic being discussed. I am totally distanced from the topic being discussed. But I am totally gone away from listening to what is being talked now. So those are barriers to listening. So you can use open-ended questions and closed-ended questions to ask questions. And barriers is, elimination is difficult to barriers of listening. May I make an attempt to minimize the barrier so that every time I'm distracted, can I quickly come back? Every time I go out of the subject, can I quickly come back? When I want to argue, can I just pause and say, let me listen fully? When I'm daydreaming, when I realize I'm wandering, can I quickly come back? So that will help in terms of focusing on the speaker to ensure that I am able to pick the information as much as possible so that I can decode it with my structure and use it and apply it in my life. Okay, so we looked at communication model. We looked at one-way, two-way communication. We looked at 5 C's. We looked at Albert Mehrabian's study. We looked at questioning and listening skills. I wanted to share some insights about email etiquette. This is not comprehensive. I'm just sharing some points. There are a lot many points. In fact, email etiquette itself can be a 3-hour session. It's so much detailed about it. So emailing is becoming, although it is fading away, it got started in the mid-90s. It is fading away to a certain extent thanks to the social media revolution and WhatsApp communication, messenger communication, social messenger communication. But let me tell you that email is still being followed by predominant of the people for formal communication. Earlier, what was written in a paper and posted, that was a formal communication. Now, email has become a formal communication to a large extent. So email is being used. So please spend a lot of time in picking up email etiquette when you have to write to your prospective employers or when you are networking with people. It's extremely important that you are picking up the not only the 5 C's, but also etiquettes related to email, or if you're using social media communication, also social media etiquette is extremely important to be used. So what are some of the aspects of it in email etiquette that I must keep in mind? One, what is the purpose of writing this message? What do I want the other person to do once the message is received? So that's one. May I focus on my objective? What is that objective? To inform, to ask, or to seek? To inform is means to tell. To ask is either to ask for permission or ask for information or ask for an appointment. So I'm asking for it. To seek. I'm seeking some details. I'm seeking some clarification. I'm seeking sometimes some extra information that is required. So either I'm informing, asking is something that is formally done. So may I come and meet up with you, sir? So I write down all that. So may I come and meet up with you? May I call you at your convenience to discuss about this? So all that would be asking. So you can also do a seeking. It's a different way. I'm seeking a little more information. So that's an objective. Focus on the content. So one is that don't have too much. One of the requests in email is that pick one topic and write on that. When you're writing to somebody, you have 3 topics to write. I would urge you to prioritize and write only one at a time. People don't read 3-4, unless there is an exchange of communication happening where you already have communicated with that person, you already spoken to that person and saying that I'm going to write you, then yes, you do that. But otherwise, it's always good to write one topic in focus. So don't go around with other information and focus on the main one. In the line section, I mean, 2-line, if you notice in the email, there is a 2-line, there is a CC line, and there is a BCC line. Let me take a moment to tell you what is this 2-line and CC line and BCC line. I don't know if how many of you would be aware once upon a time when the world was surviving on only on paper, there was no email communication. I'm talking about the 80s world where I belong. So when you write a letter, let's say I am writing a letter to Shasun Jain College for Women. I am writing a letter to the principal of the college. So I also want this message to be known to the person who referred me to the principal. So I'm marking what is called as a CC. So the CC here is actually means carbon copy. Now, what I used to do in the letter is that I will put the letter on top. On the top, I'll have 3 letters. I'll put carbon in between. Actually, it was done in quadruplicate sometimes, which means that 4 papers put in, 3 carbon papers put in. So, to the principal, Shasun Jain College, T. Nagar, Chennai, ma'am, I'm writing for this blah, 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 blah. I write it down. Thank you very much. PK Raghunathan Learning Circle Academy. I put it down there. Now I want to make a reference to somebody who referred, who is also known to your principal, for example. So I say there, CC, I put there, she knows. The principal knows that this letter is being copied. So CC to So I will write ABC from wherever he or she is. I write it down. Now in the original letter, I don't have to make any reference because the letter is addressed to Principal Ma'am. Now in the first carbon copy, I tick there. So tick means that that's a carbon copy for that particular person. Now this is clear. This is easy. So why am I sending the carbon copy? For you to know. There is no action required. What could be the action that could be required? Principal Ma'am may call this gentleman and say, Raghunathan from Learning Circle Academy has written to me a letter. Now, did you make the reference? So the person will say, yes, ma'am, I made the reference. That's all is there. Otherwise, I'm not expecting any action to be taken by that particular person. So there is a 2, there is a CC, which means that carbon copy. But I also want to tell my partner, for example, this I'm talking about the 80s world. I also want my partner to know that there is a communication that is going on from my side to Shasun Jain's College Principal Ma'am. And I am marking a reference to the person who referred. So in the third copy, I may type out again there called BCC, which means that it's a blind carbon copy. So in that blind, I'll say BCC and type out my colleague's name or partner's name and ABC and leave it there for him or her to know. Now there is a 2, there is a CC, there is a BCC. I may keep a 4th copy for my records. That's how the world used to work once upon a time. Now, this world has changed. Now this is email world. So when I write to 2, which means that I am expecting the person for the 2 person to act on it. CC is only for information and BCC for the person to know that there's an exchange going on. It's only for you to know. You don't have to do anything about it. I'm not expecting my partner to do anything with that information other than maybe talking to me about it or writing to me about it. That's how the origin is of the CC and the BCC part of it. Now, the important aspect of it, if you want somebody else also to act on your message, it must go to the 2 line. It must not be in the CC line. Now, the CC line, again, please remember, don't put too many people in the 2, too many people in the C. One thing that happens, you are not probably yet familiar to the corporate world. In corporate world, people send CC to everybody in the world to know about, which is a very wrong way of communicating. You just have to tell concerned people, one person or 2 people who should know about it as information. Because what happens is that, so what if I send it to everybody? There is an overload in terms of emails being received. So every time they receive an email from you, they think that this is not important. This is anyway a CC. So even if it's a message too, they may not take it with seriousness. So please be careful when you mark a CC formally. So sometimes it's also useful, which I've learned it from somebody else, is that in the 2, once you come to the body of it, so there is a 2, there is a CC, there is a BC, there is a subject line. Now in that below, when I say that, dear ma'am, whatever principal I put there, below it is always good to say CC to so-and-so for information. So the person knows, okay, I just have to read it. Nothing for me to act on. So just be cautious about it. And also remember that in terms of when we come to the subject line, which is the next part of it, it must actually summarize the message. Whether you're asking, whether you're telling, whether you want them to do something, whatever it is. So it's extremely important, just like newspaper walas spend time in preparing the headline for that particular article. Sometimes we say that the titles are misleading. Exactly. So we also end up misleading our receivers of communication by writing something that we don't not intend to. So extremely be careful about the subject line. And please, please, please don't use capital letters either in the subject line or in the body, because capital letters means you are shouting, you are angry. So please be careful in writing capital words, unless you want to make an emphasis of one word or two words. So those words, yes, you can highlight it or you can put it in bold or whatever, but not the body of the message to be there in capital. Also, as we talked about correctness, please ensure that the salutations are very well correctly done. What are the common actions that we are expecting somebody to do? So action one is that please provide the report. So it means that I want you to do something about it within this particular time. So that's an action report. So I want you to respond. So can you attend this meeting? So there's a response to be done. Or it's only reading, just for information, just FII, which is what commonly is used. But don't use it in your formal communication to write to somebody else. Don't say FII. You can still say, dear sir, this email I'm writing to you to share my my research report or my article. This is for your kind information. So please mention that. Although FII is sufficient. So which is what comes about it in terms of next one, for information only. Just for information, just there for your records. Please, please, please be careful. An email one said cannot be retrieved. Although a lot of people are talking about you can stop it, you can prevent it. WhatsApp also, I mean, people say you can delete it, but if the person has seen it, I mean, you can delete it, but the person has seen it. So likewise, please be very, very careful. It is not entirely private. The moment you put in there, it is public. Forget about Google reading about it or your whoever is a service provider reading about it. It is not public. So sometimes many of the people there, it's visible corporates when it goes to them. It is stored in public. It is stored in their servers. So it's all accessible for viewing if required. It's not that mails are read by everybody. No, mails are not read by anybody. But it is not totally private. It is not that he will not read it. For example, a letter you can post saying that personal and confidential. So this is not actually confidential as much as we think it is. Okay, so I've written down social media etiquette there below. So yeah, please read about social media etiquette, how to use Facebook, how to use LinkedIn, how to use Twitter, how to use WhatsApp. So a lot more to do about it. Okay, so we've come to the end of it. Let's quickly look in terms of, does it matter how I speak and write? I suppose it does matter a lot. Is there a difference? Of course, there's a lot of difference, especially in terms of how I communicate through my tone, through my body language. It's extremely important how to make myself effective. We talked about the communication model. We talked about the 5 C's. We talked about one-way, two-way communication. We talked about how to ask questions, how to do listening. We also looked at how to do the email etiquette part of it. Now, okay. So that's in terms of my request would be, since we would be moving on to the motivation session, so whatever questions you have now, please write it in your paper and share it later on at the end of this motivation session so that you can type out your questions and then we can discuss it later on. So what is motivation? That's a question being asked. What are the types of motivation? And how to implement it for self and others? How do I motivate myself and how do I motivate others? So all that, we have to look at it from this perspective. So what is it? What are the types and how to implement it for self and others? First, let's look at what is motivation. So it's an entire desire to accomplish something that is important to us. So what are all aspects of it is, there is an internal desire to accomplish, which is important. So there is an internal desire to accomplish, which is important to us. That motivation makes us to take action, whether it is getting up in the morning or keeping us awake or even working hard when we are tired, pushing ourselves extra, all that comes about it from motivation, either external or internal. Ideally, it must be from internal, but sometimes it can also be external. We look at it. We look at some of the models of motivation, okay? And then we look at one little more in detail. So there are several theories of motivation. David McClelland, is known for a lot of work. His work has sparked off a huge research by Peter Sonje, who himself has become a major guru, who's written books on David McLellan has looked at a lot of books on organizational development. Peter Sonje has written books in terms of how to make organizations a learning organization. He's also written books on how to make educational institutions a learning organization. He's written a book called School. When I say he's not written, he's worked with several other writers and is involved in that, but it was initiated by him. He's written a book called Schools That Learn, Dance to Change. So several books that he's been involved in that. His guru is David McLellan. David McLellan looked at the theory in terms of three aspects of it. So David McLellan says, we are driven by one of these, or two of these, or in many cases, all of these. Even if you're driven by all of these, we are driven by one aspect of it, which is stronger. So what are the three aspects of it? So he calls it the three needs. So need for achievement, which means that I set myself a target and I have to achieve that. That's the focus that I have. I set a target. I have to complete this task by this. I have to read this book by this time. I have to complete cooking by this time. I have to prepare this report by this time. So that's achievement driven. Now there is an affiliation driven. I like to be with people. I like to work with people. It's extremely important that working with people, being with people, staying with people is extremely important there. So that's the second type of a need. The third type of a need is need for power, need for achievement, need for success, need for authority. So it's extremely focused on power, success, authority. So that's the drive that makes it. So people, the first category we talked about, need for achievement. I want to achieve for my satisfaction. But the third category of people where need for power, they will do it if it proves something to somebody else. Just for their own satisfaction, they may not have a drive. See, I proved it to you. I know I can do it. I know I'm the leader of this group. I know that I can do better than other people. I know this. That's how the perspective will come in. They need to acquire that power. It's extremely important for them. They need to sort of dominate the group. They must be able to control it. They must be able to exercise their authority. They must be able to demonstrate the success to them. Typically, captains of the team or the heads of the team, yes. But it does not mean that all the captains of the team, all the heads of the team come from the power perspective. But some of them do come from, you need not be a captain, yet they may come from a power perspective. So one of the questions you have to ask yourself when we are discussing these theories and the concept of motivation, where am I on this? What drives me? Sometimes I will succeed if there are people with me, which means that I will work to achieve something for myself if I am with people, which means that affiliation is important for me to achieve. So affiliation comes first. If achievement is important, people being there is okay, means that success with, I mean, I will achieve it. I will complete the report. I will complete the assignment. If you're there with me, fine. If you're not there, it's okay. But if you're there, it will help me, means that I can do it myself. But if you're there, it'll help me, means that achievement is number one. Relationships or people is number two, which means that he or she can work without that person's help or support. So please ask yourself that question. Where am I on this in terms of this three aspects of it? Which one drives me? Which one pushes me? We will have all of it, but in terms of to what extent, one of them will be a dominant one. So just be aware of it. Which one is my dominant one? So you know that that drives me. So if I have to work with people to achieve, so need for affiliation is more. So look for people to work, look for teams to work, form groups and work so that you, your interrelationship is also there, you also able to achieve your objective. So that's David McClellan. Theory X and Y, Douglas McGregor, some of you who may have read about it, may be familiar with it. So if you're aware of it, great. So what did he talk about it? Theory X and Theory Y. Theory X typically in the world 60, 70 years back, they wrote saying that people were driven, even now commonly which is used, is that people are driven by either carrot or stick. What is carrot or stick? If I threaten you, you will work, which is a stick. If I give you an incentive, you will work. That's the carrot. So that's a Theory X people, Douglas McGregor said. Theory Y, Douglas McGregor says that people want independence, people want freedom, people want responsibility, people want accomplishment, people want to push themselves, they don't need external support. People are driven by self-fulfillment. That's what he said. When the theories were written, he says that Theory X is wrong, Theory Y is right. But a lot of people have subsequently came and said, it is not that Theory X is wrong or Theory Y is right. Theory Y is good to have, but Theory X is still there. It's not that Theory X has got eliminated as people expected it to be. It's not that all of us are driven on ourselves. We are still need to be pushed. We still need to be threatened. We still need to be incentivized. We still need to be given the carrot or the stick. So just be aware of it. Douglas McGregor, Theory X and Y. It is not, earlier it used to be this or that. I think now it's moving towards people are this and that. Yes, it should be more of Theory Y, but still Theory X is prevalent. So that's Douglas McGregor. Now this is the third one, Herzberg. Herzberg, something similar to Theory X and Y, but he made it a little different. He called it hygiene factors and motivation factors. I'll give you a very simple example. Now light being there, clean room being there, clean toilet being there. Is it a hygiene factor or a motivation factor? It's a hygiene factor. The beauty of the hygiene factor is that if it is there, it is not going to give me happiness. It is not going to excite me. It is not going to drive me. Like, for example, I'm sitting on a table and talking to you. Is table a hygiene factor or a motivation factor? It's a hygiene factor. You remove the table, I will be dissatisfied. You give me a better table, I'm not going to be motivated. You're giving me a table, maybe brief moment I might be motivated for a minute or two, but after that it's okay. So there are hygiene factors and motivation factors. The classic example taken is that a clean toilet is a hygiene factor. A dirty toilet is a unhygiene factor, which means that I may not want to be there. Like you visit some relatives and you see the toilet is not clean. You may not want to be there for long. The surroundings in the house is not kept clean. The plates are not clean. But the relationship is good. Will you stay? You will minimize it. Can I eat in banana leaf? Can I go out and come? You may want to go out somewhere, use some other toilet and come. So you may do that. So that's exactly what this not being there will dissatisfy me. This being there will not excite me. However, there are motivation factors, achievement or recognition or extra responsibility be given, clarity of responsibility be given, challenging work being given, progression in my growth being given, personal development. All these are motivating factors for me. So they are not demotivating factors. They are motivating factors. You give it to me, I will be motivated. In the other aspect, you give it to me, fine. That's all. It's not going to excite me. But you don't give me an achievement, it is going to demotivate me. It's going to make me very upset about it and may reflect on my performance. So that's a Herzberg theory. So we looked at Douglas McGregor, we looked at McClellan, we looked at Herzberg. Now let's look at fourth one in a little more in detail. What is recognition? It's related to motivation. A smile or a compliment or even a frown or all show that existence has been recognized. A and B are walking on the road. A says this or A puts a smile. A puts a frown. All these are recognition. A sees B, does not acknowledge, just keeps walking past. As seen B is coming in, just walks away. does not even acknowledge is there. B wonders, there is no recognition for B. There is no smile, there is no frown, there is no hi, there is no acknowledgement, there's nothing. So Eric Byrne, a transaction analysis guru, says that recognition hunger, use the term recognition hunger, we are all hungry for recognition. We ask, how have I done? Have I done well? Have I done it good? So we ask for recognition. No, it's not done well. Oh, acha, okay. We are still okay. Because response we are seeking, recognition we are seeking. It's extremely important. What is a stroke? So which we talked about as an example, you're walking along the street, you catch sight of a neighbor, you say smile, you say nice day, your neighbor smiles, you come out of the apartment, your apartment, another member of the other apartment comes out, you say hi, how are you doing? He says fine. So each exchange of it is a stroke. Something that has happened, something that got connected. Suppose you say hi and he just walks off, you'll wonder what happened. So when you exchange these are called strokes, which is what we'll be spending a little more time to understand, which is also called, a stroke is called as a unit of recognition. So which means that it is not that we are looking for recognition once in a day. We're not looking for recognition once in a time. There is a continuous interaction, continuous recognition, continuous exchange of strokes. Just keep that perspective. Each time when you talk to somebody, so many strokes have been exchanged in a conversation. So many exchanges that you make on WhatsApp or on social media, so many strokes have been exchanged. It is not that only when I put a smiley that a stroke has been exchanged. Even when you don't put anything there, you type out something, that's a stroke being exchanged. When you type, when you put in one letter, one word, three words, whatever, there is an exchange that has happened. Strokes can be classified into verbal or non-verbal. It can be categorized into three ways. One is verbal or non-verbal. So I speak, I show it in my face or my body language. So verbal or non-verbal. It can be positive or it can be negative. It can be conditional or it can be unconditional. So if you look at the combinations of these verbal, non-verbal, positive, negative, conditional and unconditional, you will get 8 types of strokes. So it can be verbal, positive, conditional. It can be verbal, positive, unconditional. It can be verbal, negative, conditional. Verbal, negative, unconditional. Non-verbal, positive, conditional. So likewise, you'll get 8 varieties of these strokes. So every exchange of it, so there is a verbal or non-verbal, there is a positive or negative, there is conditional or unconditional. So it's extremely important. Motivation here in our discussion, it is not just that I call somebody and say you've done a great job and the conversation is over, the person is motivated and he will work. No. It is continuous. Every exchange, every interaction. Let's take a simple example of a family. Now, let's say there is a brother and sister. The brother has just got something. Brother is, let's say, 16 years old. Brother has come saying that, Akka, I have done this. And so you acknowledge, you appreciate, you recognize. After that, after 5 minutes, the brother walks around and says, have you done this? Or he asks me something. The conversation continues. The motivation continues. The recognition continues. The strokes continue. It's not mean that I have given him recognition there. In this conversation, I can shout at him and he will still be motivated by what he did earlier. It's a continuous, it's extremely important. So it is not that one, it is a holistic strokes, recognition, motivation is holistic. It is does not mean that even taking hygiene factors or theory X or Y, it is not that I've given one task means that the person is happy about it. You give a task, you ask him to, you give him additional tasks, you give him additional responsibilities, you ask him to present, you ask him to teach, you ask him to explain, you ask him to demonstrate. So it's a continuous whereby these motivation is sustained. It is not one time, it is continuous. Right from the morning, we have woken up, Till the night we sleep, even in the night when we are sleeping, when you're dreaming, something subconscious is driven, but even keeping the waking hours in mind, from the time I wake up till I sleep, I need to be charged up, I need to be motivated right through, either by somebody else or by my own self. So positive and negative stroke, we talked about different types of it. Let's take some examples of it. Positive stroke is one that the giver of the stroke intends to be pleasant. It's nice to get a positive stroke. All of us like positive strokes, but it does not mean that only positive strokes are required. Negative strokes, that is intended to be painful, but sometimes a painful stroke is also required to help somebody understand and to grow further from there. What does stroking do? So it reinforces the behavior in terms of, if it's positive, it reinforces it. Negative, it reinforces that also. So it's not that only a child, when it accomplishes, a 3-month-old child or a 6-month-old child smiles. So you say, wow, you cuddle, you talk, you relate. And adjacent to, there is 75-year-old or 80-year-old man sitting there, you ignore. That person also needs strokes. It's not that only 6 months needs strokes. The time I was born till the time I leave this world, I need strokes from people or for myself. And I also need to give strokes to people. So it's extremely important, grown-ups needing strokes just as much as infants, are just as ready to mold their behavior in whatever way seems most effective to keep the stroke coming in. You acknowledge the old man sitting there, you appreciate something, he will repeat it to get more strokes from you. You have acknowledged him, you have taken care of him, he would want you to, suppose he shows you something. Typically, I found that they will, there is somebody whom I know who is into philately. Am I right? Philately, yeah, stamp collection. He's also into, I think, numismatics. He also collects coins. So he's about 85 years old. He comes, when he comes to my place or when I visit him, he spends time talking to me about the collection. Can I tell him, what uncle, you're 85 years old. What is wrong with you? What have I given? I've given him a negative stroke. Two, what is he thinking next time when he's got something to share? Forget stamps being shown. He wants to talk about something useful. He may not come to me. He will ignore. So when I give him negative strokes, which is not required, I stop getting strokes from him. Please remember, it is not strokes one way. It's two way. What are the examples for it? Positive conditions. We talked about verbal, non-verbal, positive, negative, and conditional and unconditional. So what is a positive conditional? So positive conditional is that when you specifically focus on the task that has been accomplished and you appreciate that, that was a good piece of work you did. That was a wonderful sambar you made today. That was a wonderful curry you made today. This is a nice piece of dress you're wearing. Your presentation, which you made yesterday for the group of students, was wonderful. When you explained the concept, it was very nice and easy to understand and made it excellent in terms of applying it. Now, those are all positive conditional strokes. Conditional means that focusing on that specific task. Positive unconditional. Now the conditional is for the doing, unconditional is for the being, for the person. You are lovely to you have around. You are a great person. You are a smart person. You are a wonderful person. You are an excellent person. You are a capable person. So all these are unconditional positive. So we looked at conditional positive. We are also looking at unconditional positive. Now let's look at what is the other side of it. Negative unconditional. Socks is smelling badly. I have to tell, I don't like your socks, or your socks are stinky. The sambar you made has a little more salt, or the coffee is tasting like tea, whatever. I'm just saying. So negative, it's a negative, but it's conditional to the doing. It is not to the being. negative unconditional, I hate you, I dislike you, I don't like the way you are, and all that negative unconditional. If there is one message you want to take from this session of motivation, is a humble request, don't use negative unconditional. No use at all. Yes, people use it on us. We also use it on people. Be conscious of it. The question that will be asked, if somebody says, I hate you, what should I do? Ask them, what in me that makes them to hate me? So convert that unconditional to conditional. Actually, they wanted to give you a feedback of something that you did, which was not liked by them, but they didn't express it as conditional negative. They expressed it as unconditional negative. So instead of when they say, I hate you, and if you want to actually say, I hate you too. So instead of saying, I hate you too, turn it around for a brief moment, reflect and ask yourself, and then ask, what in me that you did which you hate? So now you have converted from the hatred to the being to disliking the doing. So when you ask what I did that you don't like or you hate, then he or she has to explain now. You just can't say, no, nothing you do, I don't like. If they say, nothing you do, I don't like, tell me three things that you don't like what I did. Now they have to pick. It will make them uncomfortable. They'll say, no. So you know that they don't have anything to say. So you can turn around and saying that. So either you tell me what are the three things that you don't like at me, or you tell me that you like me. Because there's nothing that I do is disliked by you. Because what I do is disliked by you, you should be able to tell me about it. Don't say I hate you. Don't say I don't like you. So say specifically. So it's extremely important, especially when we get negative unconditional. Also, one of the recommendations made is that maybe you don't have to ask the person immediately. Take a moment, maybe wait for some time. Maybe the person is in angry mode. Maybe the person is upset mode. Maybe something else has affected, which has caused him or her to pour it on you. So just wait for a while, maybe 30 minutes, 60 minutes, maybe few hours. Then you go back and say, you told me this, I hate you. Could you tell me what made you to hate me? What did I do to make you hate me? Probably in 90% of the cases, turn around and say, I'm really sorry. I was under pressure. That's not what I meant. I'm really sorry. That's not what I should have said. You are a wonderful person. Actually, what you do, I like. It is just that at that, so you got clarified. But why should I go and ask? If you don't ask, who suffers? You suffer or the other person suffers? If the other person suffers, the person will come back later and say, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said this. But here in this case, I heard the person telling me hate. He or she has walked off. Who's suffering? I'm suffering. So what should I do? But after a few hours, the person is not responding. Eventually, the person will change. See, if you are having a relationship, it could be a mother or a father or uncle or aunt or a brother or a sibling or a relative or a neighbor, you know that person for long enough. Maybe it was just a spur of the moment. So it does not mean that you should not go and ask. You should take the liberty, take the comfort to go and ask. Ask. Also, when some people turn around and say, you're lovely to have around, I like the way you do. Sometimes it's okay. I'm not saying that you should do that. Sometimes, okay, does. Can you tell me for my aspect, what is that I do you like? Because you keep telling me that I am good, I'm smart. So can you tell me, because I also know what makes me smart. So you know that, this makes them smart. Ask them always when they are comfortable to talk, free to talk. Don't nag them and say, நீங்க சொன்னீங்கல்ல நல்ல பண்றேன்ட்டு எது நல்லா பண்றேன் எது நல்லா பண்றேன். You ask, nag them, they'll say, it may turn around, actually, I don't like you. Don't convert a positive unconditional to positive, negative unconditional. Just be mindful, just be careful. So positive conditional, positive unconditional, negative conditional, and negative unconditional. So I'm just put it in a quadrant quickly to relate with that. There is one more slide. After that, we will take questions. So quadrant one is conditional positive. Unconditional positive is quadrant two. Quadrant three is conditional negative. Unconditional negative is quadrant four. Quadrant four should be eliminated. Extremely limited, rarest of the rare occasions. Avoid giving it, avoid receiving it. People give it to you, as I said, please go back and ask them. If possible, then otherwise later on, ask them what makes them to say that. So quadrant one is conditional positive. It is positive stroke you give for the doing or you receive for the doing. Unconditional positive is for the being, that the person I am, not for what I do. Conditional negative is something that I did, which is not pleasant for the other person. Unconditional negative is that it is the being which they don't like. Now, there are two aspects of it here in terms of conditional positive and conditional negative and unconditional positive. It is something I can give to others. It is something I can receive from others. It is also I can give to myself. Why should I do it for myself? I have done something good. I made a rasam. I tasted the rasam. It's come out well. We can say, excellent, good show. Nobody is there to appreciate you. Nobody needs to be there. No, people can appreciate you later. Self-appreciate. You taste the rasam. It is not tasting well. So you say, how can I take this? Nana epdi panna, yen epdi panna nana. So enna sariyilla, so uppu pottu paakala. Now it's come out well. It's okay to give a conditional negative to yourself and also conditional positive to yourself. For everything that I do, the first appreciation or criticism for the act that I did, if it comes from you, means that the change in you, the drive in you, can be more intrinsically done. You don't have to wait for others to do it. You can ask for appreciation or recognition from others. First, you should be able to do it to yourself first. But sometimes you may say, but is this great? Somewhere your mind tells you it is great. So appreciate it. Don't be overly critical. I determined to read 50 pages in about 3 hours. You read 50 pages. Tell yourself, Raghu, good job. You said you'll do it in 3 hours. You did it. It is not that you have to say it loudly. You can say it loudly also if you're comfortable. Just tell yourself, good show. Read 50 pages in 3 hours. You have read about it. Great. So that's a stroke you give. The more you stroke yourself, the more confidence gets built in internally for you. Okay, this is something I would like you to do it either now or either later. You can take the screenshot and do this later, or you can write it down and do it now or do it later. Just do a self-analysis, which is also called as a stroke profile. How comfortable am I in giving strokes to people? This is in giving. How comfortable am I in giving? No, I'm very comfortable in giving. How frequently do you give? It is not that I give a stroke to my brother once in a day. He walks around, you walk, talking to him, pleasant conversation, fun conversation, all are strokes. How comfortable am I in doing that, positive and negative? How comfortable am I in taking or accepting positive and negative stroke? Raghu, you've done a wonderful job in this particular task. Okay, sir. Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I am not comfortable. Make yourself comfortable in accepting or receiving strokes. How comfortable are you in asking for strokes? Go and ask for strokes. The rasam has come out well. I prepared the report and I submitted to ma'am, and ma'am said, said nothing. So after 3-4 days, ma'am, did you read my report? How was it? Yeah, it was nice. Did you read it thoroughly? What did you like in that? Go ask for strokes. Go ask for strokes with family members. The biggest challenge today is that the strokes are not much exchanged between family members and friends. Yes, there is conversation going on. Sometimes it's good to appreciate, acknowledge, recognize people. Sometimes they give you, like I talked about, I hate you. So you don't have to accept that. How comfortable sometimes am I to even reject a negative stroke? Sometimes I am not comfortable receiving a positive stroke because I sense it is not coming with genuinity. So fine, don't take it. How do I know? This only comes by experience. We don't have time to explain that here, but just be cognizant of that. And how comfortable am I in giving strokes to myself? Positive and negative. Like this session will be completed at 4 o'clock. What am I going to do at 4 o'clock? Okay, I did a webinar for Shasun Jain College. There were X number of students and I'm just going to walk off. I'm going to look at it. Raghu, yes, you did this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 well. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, maybe you didn't do it well. So I have to do that first to myself. Maybe I will ask somebody else my partner is watching it. So I'll ask him, so how did you find? Maybe my wife, I'll ask her to watch this video, some of it, and say, tell me what you liked in that. Good to go and ask. It's perfectly all right. Yeah. So this is in terms of strokes. So we looked at David McClellan, Douglas McGregor, Herzberg. We looked at recognition. Your stroke is a unit of recognition. We looked at positive and negative strokes. We looked at there are 8 varieties of strokes. So there is positive, negative, verbal, non-verbal, conditional and unconditional. When you do the combinations, you will get 8 varieties of strokes. So also do stroke profile. How comfortable am I in giving, in receiving, in asking and refusing, and also in giving for my own self. Okay, just to quickly look into it. So what is motivation? What are the types of it? There are several more types of motivation. I urge you to. There is a famous one, Maslow's Needs of Hierarchy, Maslow's Needs of Motivation. You can read about it. There is Daniel Pink who talks about it in his one of the books, his aspect of motivation. So there are different more types that are available that you can go and read about it. How to implement for self and others. Yes, please be conscious about giving to yourself and please be conscious of giving to others and also be comfortable in receiving from others. So this is in terms of the learning objectives for motivation. Tomorrow we will be doing a session which will be the final webinar series of this 3-part series, Self-Analysis and Personal Branding 1.0. Please read about it. Maybe it will help you to come prepared for tomorrow's presentation on self-analysis and personal branding. I will cover a couple of self-analysis tools. So in terms of questions, now please feel free to type out your questions. Your classmate, your colleague, Vedika is here with us, who will read out, because yesterday we felt there was a lot of time lag. So we felt that it would be good instead of me browsing through and reading those questions and then responding. So there's a huge time lag, so to speed it up. So we thought it's good to have somebody with us to be sitting and reading out the questions. So Vedika, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, sir. Sure. I'm here.
So after that, in about 10-15 minutes, I will put this feedback form, the Google form in the comment sections for you to put your feedback form to your colleagues back to them. I'll also share our Telegram channel. If you wish to, you can join our Telegram channel to get updates about various free webinars and paid seminars that we do. So we can get updates to join that. So you're most welcome to join that. In fact, we are conducting one webinar, which will be a free webinar this Saturday. So If you join the Telegram link, you'll be able to get to know, because I don't know whether we have your email IDs to be able to reach out to you. So in a moment, I will update that. So before I proceed to responding to questions, thank you very much for your time. It's 3:35, so we have another 25 minutes. So please feel free to ask your questions. At about 3:45, 3:50, I will post the Google form on your comment section. So are there any questions coming in, Vedika?
Yes, sir. There's a question from Aishwarya Krishnamurthy. Okay. She's asking, like, obviously, like, in between siblings, there'll be so many fights, dog and cat fight. So, question.
What is life? What is life without the dog and cat fights with your sibling?
Yes, sir, absolutely. So her question is, if she says a negative sentence to her brother, and the brother is not willing to understand, so how does she convey the message in such a way that he understands and takes it in a positive manner and works on it rather than criticizing?
You are giving a negative and you're asking the person to take it positive. Okay, that itself is, I'm a little wondering. Okay, the point is that don't make it manipulative. You want to say something, you don't like it. Okay, there are two approaches to it. One, you tell straight, saying that enakku idhu nee idhu pannadhu enakku pidikala. In simple words, it makes it. Sometimes in a formal communication, when you don't know each other so well, it is good to use a sandwich approach where you talk something positive and make information, reference to the negative that you don't like about it, what the person did, and then again talk something positive. Here the issue could be that sometimes let's go back to the communication part of it. Sometimes I may use words which he may not understand. So there could be a languaging issue, or there could be a choice of words issue. The second aspect of it also is that in this, it also could mean that timing of that. Let's say the incident happened yesterday or day before. People may have forgotten. People may have forgotten the intensity also. There's also a need for a spontaneity. Any other questions, Vedika?
More than the questions, sir, we're getting feedback saying it was a wonderful session and people like really understood it clearly. Wonderful. They took the clarity point really seriously, I guess.
Wonderful, wonderful. I'm really happy about it. Please feel free to connect with me in terms of, I've given you my LinkedIn connection. All of it is PK Raghunathan. So whether it's LinkedIn or Facebook or Twitter, I'm fairly active on LinkedIn, so it's also good to, tomorrow we will be talking a little bit about that. So good to be present definitely on LinkedIn and Facebook. So I'm stopping the share right now so that I can, any other questions coming in?
Yes, sir. There are a few questions from my side.
Okay, very good.
Yes, sir. So you mentioned about social media does not spoil the English grammar or the language grammar.
No, I'm not saying it does not spoil. Be mindful when you are communicating in a formal setup. You are communicating somebody to authority, to your professor or to your principal or to somebody in the corporate world. Just be mindful of that in terms of using the appropriate words, rather than you can't put there ROFL or LOL or put a big laughter there and send it. They'll wonder, I mean, There is a distance there. Proximity has still not been established. Just be mindful of that.
Yes, right, sir. So that's what, because many people, they switch off their autocorrect and then they type and there'll be like so many mistakes, which does not allow them to improve on their spellings.
Yeah, okay. So what is the question?
No, I just wanted to tell that point, sir.
Okay, fair enough. No. Oh, snafus have happened. Snafu is situation normal, all fouled up. So I wanted to communicate and I made a mess of my communication. Yeah, it happens. See, one thing is you made a mistake, you want to communicate and you're not able to delete. Apologize. I'm really sorry. See, as students, they also know that you are in your fun mode. You are in the mode of communicating with your friends in the same frame of mind. They understand. See, I am 54. So don't I know when a 21-year-old makes a mistake that I've been a 21-year-old once? It does not mean that I don't know. So people are aware of it. Yeah. Any other?
Yes, sir. How do one motivate oneself? Like, there are like so many factors that one person can use. Is there something particular or some particular?
You wear your new dress. Who needs to appreciate yourself first? You comb your hair. I'm taking small things in life. You comb your hair. Who has to appreciate yourself first? You wrote a small poem. Who has to appreciate you first? It's yourself.
Yes, sir.
Starts there. Yeah.
There's another question from Aishwarya. She says in school letters, they use capital letters. So when it comes to emails, can they use that capital letters for official purposes?
It is always preferable, unless you want to highlight a particular word in the communication, whether it is WhatsApp communication or email communication, other than that one or two keywords, it is better not to use capital words. It means it communicates that you're shouting. There are industry leaders who use capital letters in Twitter. It's not correct. Just because they use it doesn't mean it's correct.
Yes,
so you'll find many of the celebrities, whether it is film stars in Tamil Nadu, or they use a lot of it using the local language. See, the beauty in the local language is that Hindi, Tamil, Telugu, there is no capital letter or a small letter. So there's a beauty in that. English has this capital letter and small letter. So I have to be mindful of that.
Yes, sir, you're right.
So
I would like to mention a point here. I don't know how many of them actually noticed. In the PPT which you presented.
Okay.
There were some quotes in it. I really loved it, especially in the theory X and theory Y slide. There was a quote, if you don't mind me reading that out.
Please, okay.
Yes, there was a quote saying, if you're bored with life, you don't get up every morning with a burning desire to do things. You don't have enough goals. I that really hit me hard.
Okay.
I don't know how many of them noticed. So I just wanted to...
Good. I'm happy you noticed that. In fact, the reason I put the quotes is that sometimes those messages, there is something called a subliminal learning. So sometimes when you're reading it, you're reading something else without your much of awareness. And that goes into it. So that's why some of the quotes I have put in there. Wonderful. Thank you very much, Vedika, for picking that up. Great.
Thank you. That actually really hit me hard. I couldn't get that off my mind.
Okay. I'm glad you shared it too. Okay.
Thank you, sir. There's one more question from Satyavati.
Okay.
Sometimes what elders say might be wrong. So how we as youngsters should correct them in polished way so that they
you should correct. I'm so happy that you're bringing this. I've got two sons and they keep telling me feedback. Is it palatable? Sometimes it is not palatable. But in terms of, please, one thing let me tell you that as parents or as elders, they are very happy to receive feedback from you, even if it is unpleasant. The reason is that they come with the perspective that in today's world situation, you are able to relate with it better than they are able to do that. So there is a belief that there is a strong belief in them that you know a lot. You see the world with a different eyes than what they see. You see the world with a different perspective. So they are more than happy to receive your input. So please feel free to share. You don't have to work very hard, whether it's a father, mother, or uncle. Just walk across and say, uncle, father, I would like to share this insight with you. I found it as a young person, I did not like it, or I thought this is what it meant. I did not take it very well. So I'll be happy if you don't use it. Maybe it will be difficult for them. But slowly they will think through, I have not thought from their angle at all. So it's perfectly all right to go. Please go. Okay, one or two people may not like it. See, the world is not made by one or two. The world is made with about 8 billion people, and we don't have opportunity to interact with 8 billion. Our interaction probably would be in thousands in all our life. Of that 10, 20, 100 may not like what you say. Am I going to be determined by 10, 20, 100 to interact with the rest of the 9,980 people or 9,900 people? No. So it would be helpful to be able to go and share it. They'll be very receptive, very encouraging. So when you are encouraged, you know that you have received a stroke for it. You have given them a stroke for it. So it will only build in through these strokes. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Yes.
So, sir, there's one more question. Do you feel social media has had a huge effect on face-to-face communication?
Has it impacted the face-to-face communication?
Yes, sir.
In fact, it has enhanced. People are spending more time on talking to people through WhatsApp video or Facebook communication. They're doing a lot more. There is a lot more interaction with relatives that happen through Facebook exchange of photographs, otherwise, which would only happen when you get to meet once in a year or once in 2 years when there is a function or when there is an event that is happening where you carry your albums and go. I'm talking about 20 years back. Now, today, you just get to exchange so much more. So there's so much of, yes, there is the other side of it, too much of it. But that's where the balancing comes in. There is, in fact, it's more productive.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. There's the second part of the question says, how does it affect someone's communication skills? Like, I guess we've already covered.
That's a very good question. Actually, yes, it has started impacting them from a negative perspective. People started using short words. People started using more emojis, emoticons. People put ROFL. Honestly, nobody rolls on the floor and laughs.
Yes,
so,
sir.
So nobody's going to roll and do that. So, but when you put it, so those aspects of it, it has gone to the other end of it. So yes, that's a bit of, that's where the being mindful of it. If you look at it in terms of exchange of it, it depends on which group you are in, where such exchange happen. You are in a formal group, such exchanges don't happen actually. So it's still formal communication only happens.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm sharing the feedback form now.
Yes, yeah? Please.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. The third part and the last part of the question was, will it affect the way they communicate in a formal setting in a corporate world or a corporate environment?
It seems to be Vedika, it seems to be impacting. So we have to be careful that Facebook is not the world that we are in. There is another world that we are in. For example, these webinars that are there, you will not find it being different from the, let's say, classroom seminars or convention hall seminars. It has only replaced it with the screen being there. So we must be careful that the reflection of what we there in Facebook is only maintained there and is not brought in, because in formal setup, you walk in, you meet, you exchange greetings, you do some small talk, you listen to their explanations. It's all very formal. If I may use the word, structured communication happen in the formal setup. So we have to be careful for that. That's the reason I shared so many inputs, so that these are all from a formal structured perspective. So just be careful on that, that I don't carry my Facebook image when I go and meet somebody in the corporate world. Yes, there are people who have adapted to the Facebook world, LinkedIn world, they have adapted to it. LinkedIn is extremely formal, very, very formal. So it will, that's where I would urge people to be part of LinkedIn too. Because you'll find a lot of corporate people. So the exchange of communication that happens in Facebook is very different from what happens in LinkedIn. Totally different what happens in Twitter. So there is a lot of formality that happens in LinkedIn and in some of the exchanges in Twitter. So just be, that's something that will help you a lot.
Yes, sir. So maybe I don't see any other questions in the chat box.
Okay.
Maybe I personally have one again.
Okay.
So, sir, like, what do you, like, many people get negative feedbacks. When they get the negative feedbacks, they hold on to it and they just keep thinking negative things. How do you think they can overcome that and think beyond it instead of taking that negative thing it personally or...
You answered the question, Vedika.
Sir?
You have answered the question.
Okay.
You have answered it. How I should not take it? You answered it. Don't take it. That's what I said. Are you comfortable refusing strokes? See, negative, is it developmental or is it non-developmental? If it's developmental, take it. It is just said for the sake of it. Fine, you have a choice not to take it. People give it to you. You don't have to take it. Let's say I turn around and say, Vedika, I don't like you. You can say, okay, fine, thank you. Move on.
Yes, sir.
Because, you see, the important is that... I'm taking our own example. I know you for the last 2 hours only. So if you think that I'm not going to add value to you with my feedback, let's say I turn around and say something useful to you, Vedika, you can do this, you can do that, it will help you. If you're not clear, you can come and ask me. If I give you an unconditional negative feedback, now what do you want to do with that feedback? Don't take it. But again, looks at it. What is the equation you have with the person? It's extremely important. Your professors. Sometimes you may not like the professor. That's where there is a quote. Take the messenger. You may not take the message. You may not like the messenger. When you have dislike to one of your professors or teachers, don't forget to take the message. Number one. Number two, important. Go back to the same professor. Look at the same professor or teacher. What is that you like about this person? View it from that particular perspective. Yep.
Yes, sir.
Because everybody is good in the world. There's nobody bad in the world.
Totally agreed, sir.
Wonderful.
So everyone have completed their feedbacks, it seems.
Okay, great.
Yes, sir. And,
so do we stop it? What do we do?
I guess I don't see any other questions, sir.
Okay, what I will do is that I will put the feedback form in the public comment area. So it's available for if any of them have missed out, so they can pick it up from there. Because once we close this live show, the comment section will get closed. Okay.
Yes. Okay, sir.
I put it in the public comment section. So if they want to, they can use that.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. I think you being there was useful, Vedika. I'm so glad that because we are able to do it faster. So I think we appreciate the feedback. The feedback yesterday was that it's going a little slow. So there is an audio video lag. So I think... we spend constructive time with you observing it. So you're able to quickly reproduce the questions and ask. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So tomorrow also then you can come and then we will start from there.
Sure, sir. And we really have positive feedbacks in the chat section.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Okay. So do I... stop the live stream, may I?
Yes, please, sir, as you say.
No, because is there any questions? If there are any questions, I will wait. Otherwise, if there are no questions, so I think...
I don't see any questions. They just all are giving their wonderful and positive feedbacks.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So this is a stroke. That's a stroke.
Positive stroke.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So every thank you, every acknowledgement is a positive stroke. Feedback is not opening. Okay. Shweta Rajshekar is saying feedback is not opening. So maybe you can check that out. Is there any other way you can share the feedback? Because most of them have completed it. So only one or two are having a problem in opening in the browser, I think.
Yes, sir. Maybe they'll have to cross-check with their network.
Okay. So I'll stop the live stream now.
Yes, sure, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, friends, there watching on YouTube. I'm stopping the live stream now. See you tomorrow.